Hey man, well, it's good to be back on the radio again today. We certainly do appreciate the good Lord giving us another opportunity to be able to come to you by means of radio. This is the Bear Trail Baptist Church broadcast. We certainly are privileged to be the pastor there, Brother Tim Kratz. If you'd like more information regarding our church, you can visit our church website, beartrailbaptistchurch.com. The website will give you information regarding the location of our church, our service times. There's also a link there where you can contact us. Our phone number is on the website. You can email us directly from the website. There is a sermon audio button you can click, and you can find audio sermons preached by myself and others at our church. They'll be free for you to listen to or download. The physical address as well as the mailing address is Bear Trail Baptist Church, 100 Born Again Lane, in Cana, Virginia, and that zip code is 24317. I'd like to make this announcement regarding the Blue Ridge Baptist Camp Meeting Youth Rally. The youth rally for the Blue Ridge Baptist Camp Meeting is always held the last weekend of the month of June, and so this year that will be on Friday night, June the 28th at 6 p.m., and then again on Saturday morning, June the 29th at 10 a.m., Brother Tim Gammons will be preaching for us again during this year's youth rally. He did a tremendous job preaching last year during the youth rally. There will be games for the children, and there will also be food served after each of the services as well. There will also be a public ministry opportunity on Saturday afternoon should you choose to join us in that as well. And so keep that in mind, if you will. And that meeting will be held at the Blue Ridge Baptist Camp Meeting Building, which is located at 2049 Caudill Drive in Mount Airy, North Carolina. So keep that in mind, if you will. Also, this announcement also, the Vacation Bible School at Bear Trail Baptist Church will be held on July the 8th through the 13th. And that'll be at 7 o'clock each night, Monday through Friday, and then at 10 a.m. on Saturday morning, the 13th. So keep that in those dates in mind also, if you will. All right, we're going to go to the Lord in prayer. We're going to continue today in our Psalm 48. We started in Psalm 48 on last week's broadcast. We will continue there this week as well. Father, thank you for the privilege to pray and the privilege to be back on the radio again today. I pray you would help us, pray you would use us to be a blessing and a help to your people. I sure need your help today. I need your touch, Lord, and you allow us to preach your word, and we'll certainly not fail to thank you for that that you do, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Psalm 48, along with Psalm 46 and 47, are dealing primarily with the millennial kingdom. And of course, Psalm 45 was about a marriage of the great king, and that had to do with the church, the bride of Christ, being married to Christ, and then the millennial reign immediately following. And so Psalm 46, Psalm 47, and Psalm 48 talk about that millennial kingdom. And so we're continuing in Psalm 48 today. Psalm 48 in verse number 1 says, "Great is the Lord." We talked on last week's broadcast about many different passages of scripture in the Bible that talked about the greatness. We mentioned four things that he was great because of. He's great because there is none like him. He is great because of his loving kindness. He is great because his right hand is full of righteousness. And he is great because of his judgments. Now, I want to look at the second thing here in Psalm 48 in verse number 1 today. It says, "Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised." Now, we talked extensively about how great our Lord is, and now we want to take a brief look at the fact that he is also greatly to be praised. Now, I suppose if the Lord is great, and we would all agree that he is, especially all of us that believe the Bible, we certainly have no doubt at all whatsoever about how great our God is. In fact, we can't even explain or put into words how great our God is. And so it should be understood that because he is great, he also deserves to be praised. Now, As I mentioned on last week's broadcast, before I began preaching on the fact that great is the Lord, I made mention of the fact, I remember years ago when I was studying these Psalms and putting all of this material together, I had the thought that we certainly know all the Scripture, or maybe not all the Scripture, but we read the Scripture, we rejoice in the Scripture stirs our heart, and we know that our God is great. There's none that compares to Him at all whatsoever. But I find it also kind of sad that we have to be reminded that our God is great. And so we've been reminded that our God is great. I am also, it's humiliating to have to be reminded that He also should be praised, amen. It's not uncommon for us to praise people, we praise places, we praise things, and they may or may not deserve some sort of praise. I'm not trying to be hypercritical here, but if we do that and we refuse to give the Lord the praise that He deserves, then I think we're kind of misguided and misdirected. We will praise people, and I'm not diminishing the fact that we should be kind, we should be respectful, we should be considerate of others. I think others should be noticed. I think they should be remembered when they accomplish something that is noteworthy. I agree with all of that. But if we can praise someone else for a job well done or for a great accomplishment, why can't we praise the Lord? Because I promise you, no one has ever done anything to accomplish all that He has accomplished, and He certainly deserves our praise. Now, here's another thing as well. We praise vehicles, we praise shopping places, we praise restaurants, a certain brand of clothing or shoes or whatever that has served us well, we give those things accolades. And I hope that I am never guilty of giving more praise to an object or to a restaurant or to a person than I am my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He is our great God, and He is greatly to be praised. Now, what I want to look at on today's broadcast are some ways for us to praise Him. And so, first of all, we should praise Him publicly. Look what the Bible says in Psalm 22 and verse 22. The Bible says in Psalm 22, verse 22, I will declare thy name unto my brethren. In the midst of the congregation will I praise thee. In the midst of the congregation will I praise thee. And so apparently it is acceptable to praise the Lord in the midst of a congregation of people. It may be two people, it may be three people, it may be 500 or 5,000, but it is acceptable to praise the Lord publicly. Now, the Bible says here in this psalm, in the midst of the congregation will I praise thee. What is the congregation? How do we praise Him? Well, we can take that psalm and we can look in the New Testament, and this verse is repeated in Hebrews chapter 2 and verse number 11 and 12. I'll read both verses. Hebrews 2:11, the Bible says, for both he that sanctifieth and they that are sanctified are all of one, for which cause he is not ashamed to call them brethren. Verse 12, saying, I will declare thy name unto my brethren, in the midst of the church will I sing praise unto thee. So the church is the congregation, and we sing and praise unto Him in the congregation, in the church. So listen, I understand that a large portion of religious music today is about self-promotion. It's about self-praise. It's about personal praise. But you and I need to be caught up in singing praises to Him and about Him. Amen. Now, this same Psalm 22, verse 23 says this, ye that fear the Lord, praise Him. All ye the seed of Jacob, glorify Him, and fear Him, all ye the seed of Israel. Now, this verse seems to be a little redundant. I understand that. Jacob here, he represents either the lost or the believer who is acting according to the flesh. And I promise you, if you're lost and you have any fear at all for the wrath and the judgment of God, you should praise Him for the fact that you're not already dead and in hell. You should praise Him for the fact that you still have an opportunity and you still have breath and you still have a chance to receive the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. If you are saved and you're living according to the flesh, you fear the Lord and praise Him for sparing your life and for not and having mercy on you in your stupidity. All of us at one time or another, I don't know about you, I certainly have strayed from the Lord and went away from the things of God and found myself in places and situations and circumstances that I'm certainly not pleased with. And I thank the Lord that He has saw me through those things, amen, and had mercy on me. And I praise Him for that, amen. And so Israel here, he represents those who are acting in faith. And if anyone in this world has reason to praise the Lord, it is you and I who know Him and are walking with Him, amen. We should praise Him publicly. Listen, if you can praise a child or a grandchild that plays a sport and you can't publicly praise the Savior who died to keep you and that child from going to hell, I'd be ashamed of myself. Now, don't go away saying, the preacher said we shouldn't praise our child or our grandchild. No, I'm not saying that at all. My grandchildren, they are not all that involved in sports yet. They are to some degree, but they're really young. But they did something, you know, they hit a home run, make a three-pointer, dunk a basketball. I'm going to clap. I'm going to say, yay, good job or whatever. But listen, friend, if I can do that and I sit on my hands in church when the Lord Jesus Christ is being exalted, when He's being high and lifted up, when He's done great things for us and I sit there mum, I can't say anything about the goodness of our God. There's something wrong in my heart. Listen, and let me say something else about that while I'm on the subject. Here's what really chaps my hide as a pastor. That child never misses a practice, and that child never misses a ball game, but they miss church, and they miss church events, and worship seems to be optional for them, but the ball team and the ball game and the practice is not. I want to tell you something, friend. Your praise is misguided. God help us. God help us to get these things in line. And so we can praise Him publicly. How do we praise Him? We praise Him publicly. Second of all, we praise Him with our performance. Now, that is speaking of our life and our works. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 5 and verse 13, Jesus said this, "You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt have lost its savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is thenceforth good for nothing but to be cast out and to be trodden underfoot of men. Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick. And it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men, listen, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven." Listen, so salt, the Bible talks about we're the salt of the earth, we're the light of the world. These good works that we do, because we are salt and light, it glorifies our Father, which is in heaven. In other words, we praise Him with our performance. It brings honor and glory to the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. So listen, salt not only provides flavor, it also provides healing and it provides preserving. And so we have in the Lord Jesus Christ, we have the cure for broken lives. We have the cure for broken homes. We have knowledge of the only true preservative in the world, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ. And so if we are salty, it will cause others to glorify or to praise our Father, which is in heaven. And so when our light is shining, others will be exposed to the light of the Lord Jesus Christ, causing darkness in their life to be revealed by the light. And so may the Lord help you and I to be a shining light for the Lord Jesus Christ. Listen, if you're saved, I hope your light is bright enough to reveal the darkness in the lives of those who are unsaved. And when others see our good works, they'll know that it isn't us, but it is our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, working through us. And in turn, He gets all the glory and He gets the praise. And so our God, great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. We should praise Him publicly. We should praise Him with our performance. And third of all, we should praise Him with our productivity. So what the Bible says, Jesus again doing the speaking in John chapter 15. In John 15, in verse number 8, Jesus said, "Herein is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit, so shall ye be my disciples." Listen, we know that apple trees bear apples. We know that orange trees bear oranges. We know that tomato vines produce tomatoes. That is the fruit of the vine, etc. So if a Christian bears fruit, it seems to me that it would be another Christian. And so praising and glorifying God may not be vocal at all. I understand we are to lift up our voice like a trumpet. We saw that in Psalm 47, that we are to clap our hands. We are to sing praises unto our God. I understand all of that. But our praise could also be our productivity. It could be that we are producing the fruit of our life as a believer, as a Christian, is the product of another believer, another Christian, someone else knowing the Lord Jesus Christ. And so much of this praise can be done by our witnessing and by our winning others to the saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we can praise Him with our productivity. Number four, we praise Him in partnership with others. Now, come to Romans chapter 15. Romans chapter 15, look what the Bible says in verse number 5. Romans 15, verse number 5, the Bible says, "Now the God of patience and consolation grant you to be like-minded one toward another according to Christ Jesus, that ye may with one mind and with one mouth glorify God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ." And so listen, both Jews and Gentiles believing with one mind and confessing with one mouth, glorifying God together. Now notice the next few verses. "Now I say that Jesus Christ, as a minister of the circumcision, for the truth of God, to confirm the promises made unto the fathers, and that the Gentiles might glorify God for His mercy, as it is written, 'For this cause I will confess to thee among the Gentiles and sing unto thy name.' And again he saith, 'Rejoice ye Gentiles with His people.' And again, 'Praise ye the Lord, all ye Gentiles,' and loud," L-A-U-D, that means to praise or extol Him, "to all ye," or "all ye people." So in verse number 9, we glorify God for His mercy. We praise God. He let us in, amen. In verse number 10, we Gentiles are to rejoice with His people, the Jews. Verse number 11, "Praise ye the Lord, all ye Gentiles." And so listen, what is our excuse for not praising Him? We are to praise Him in partnership with others. So we're to praise Him publicly. Publicly, we're to praise Him with our performance, speaking of our lives and our work. We're to praise Him with our productivity. We, as believers, should be producing other believers. We are to praise Him in partnership with others. We should not be ashamed to lift up our voices with others in praise unto our great God and our Savior. And we're also to praise Him in our person. Now look what the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 16, or chapter 6, I should say, and verse 18. "Flee fornication. Every sin that a man doeth is without the body. But he that committeth fornication sinneth against his own body. What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own? For we are bought with a price." Now notice this. "Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's." So listen, are you doing anything in your body that glorifies God? Are we faithful to subject our body to the much needed prayer? It takes humility to pray. It doesn't just take your time. It takes your humility. You have to bring your body into subjection to do that which is contrary to the natural flesh, that you might pray and seek the help of the Lord. Are we conditioning our body to take time to read and study the Bible, its work? Are you faithful to bring your body to church so we can worship and learn together? Now, I'll be there in spirit, preacher. No, you're not coming. Amen. And so we need to subject our body to the things of the Lord and to the faithfulness of God. Are we using our body to be a faithful witness for the Lord Jesus Christ? Are we using our body to sing praise to His worthy name? Are we using our body to broadcast His precious name? Listen, if you're saved, your body belongs to Him, the Lord Jesus Christ. And we need to be careful how we treat another man's property. Amen. It belongs to the Lord. Now, come back to Psalm 48, and let's get a very quick overview of this entire psalm. And so the writer of this great psalm, he uses his inspired pen to extol the greatness of God, and He is indeed greatly to be praised. In fact, we can't even fathom His greatness, and we certainly cannot evaluate His glory. He is above and beyond anything the human tongue can tell, and Jerusalem comes into view as the city of our God. Now, there is no doubt here that this refers to Jerusalem, the capital of the kingdom during the millennial age, and no other city has the beauty and the glory of the city of the king. And God is known as a refuge in the palaces of this eternal city. And so we're going to take just a very brief, quick overview of this entire psalm. So first of all, in the first three verses, we see the city of the king. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised in the mountain of His holiness. Beautiful situation, the joy of the whole earth is Mount Zion on the sides of the north, the city of the great king. God is known in her palaces for a refuge. And so here, the personal pronoun her in verse number 3 is speaking of the earth, as mentioned in verse number 2. I only say that because some non-believer, agnostic, atheist, Bible-denying hypocrite has said that this is a reference to a feminine God. That's just simply because you have no understanding of English. Amen. Now, Mount Zion will become the joy of the whole earth during the kingdom age. Its glory will shine to the end of the earth. The true importance of the city is found in the fact that the king is there. The one who is greatly to be praised will be there. And God makes the difference in the lives of men here and now, as well as in the makeup of nations. And Jesus is king on this earth during this time, and His reign is glorious. And so we see the city of the king. Second of all, we see the judgment of the king in this psalm, in verses 4 through 7. Verse 4 says, "For lo, the kings were assembled, they passed by together, they saw it, and so they marveled, they were troubled and hasted away, fear took hold upon them there, and pain as of a woman in travail. Thou breakest the ships of Tarshish with an east wind." And so many nations have come against Jerusalem over the years, Babylon, Assyria, Rome, just to name a few. Zechariah 14:2 foretells the fact that God will gather all nations against Jerusalem to battle. And while it's true that Jerusalem has suffered at the hands of wicked kings such as Nebuchadnezzar, in the end, God will scatter all these nations in the day of His wrath, and Jerusalem will be spared from the wrath of angry nations and kings. And I think it is amazing that the kings of this world, with all their power and all their possessions, they will one day with wonder at the great city and marvel at the splendor of the great King. And the great is our Lord and greatly to be praised. And those kings will be troubled by his greatness, and they will haste away in fear of its power. And the pain caused by their fear will be as a woman in labor to give birth. And the millennium will bring peace and prosperity to the city. What a blessing. And so we see the city of the King, the judgment of the King, and the kingdom of the King. Look at verse number 8. As we have heard, so have we seen in the city of the Lord of hosts, in the city of our God. God will establish it forever. Selah. We have thought of thy loving kindness, O God, in the midst of thy temple. According to thy name, O God, so is thy praise unto the ends of the earth. Thy right hand is full of righteousness. Let Mount Zion rejoice. Let the daughters of Judah be glad because of thy judgments. Walk about Zion and go round about her. Tell the towers thereof. Mark ye well her bulwarks. Consider her palaces, that you may tell it to the generation following. For this God is our God forever and ever. He will be our guide even unto death. Listen, friend, when the war clouds have passed over, when the smoke has cleared and the threat of wicked nations has ended, the city of the King will be established forever. Amen. The goodness of God will be acknowledged by the people of God. We see that in verses 9 and 10. Zion rejoices as the city is compassed about by the subjects of the King. They mark its values and palaces, whose beauty will be told to generations that lead up to the establishment of the kingdom. And God is our God for eternity, and Jerusalem is forever. In fact, verse 14, the final verse of this psalm, is considered by many to be the key verse of the psalm. And it says this, "For this God is our God forever and ever. He will be our guide even unto death." What a great comfort to you and I that know the Lord Jesus Christ. We know that our King is our God, and He will be our God not just today, not just tomorrow, not just next week, but He will be our God forever and ever. He is my God now, and there's never going to be a time when He will not be my God. And not only is He my God, He is also my guide even unto death. And listen, He will not only always be God, He will always be my God, and my God will guide me even unto death. No wonder the psalmist began the psalm with, "Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised." And so you and I should just go right ahead and praise the Lord. We should clap our hands. We should sing praises to our God. We should lift up our voice like a trumpet, because our God is a God that is worthy to be praised. Now listen, here's the conclusion. During this millennial reign of Christ, when the King of glory reigns upon his earthly throne in Jerusalem, darkness will have to flee. And all I can say is, what a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. There's a great day coming for those of us that know the Lord. And I'm looking forward to the day when my faith becomes sight and I get to behold my Savior and see the one who bled and died so that I could be saved. Listen, if you're listening today and you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, the Bible says that today is the day of salvation and now is accepted time. If you die without receiving the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, you'll spend eternity separated from God in the lake of fire. Your future is the total opposite of the future of those of us who have placed our faith in Jesus Christ. You see, the Bible says that we will forever be with the Lord. He has prepared great things for those of us who know Him as our Savior. But those who die without Jesus Christ spend eternity separated from God in a Christless hell in the lake of fire, where the worm dieth not and the fire is not quenched. I implore you today to trust Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. Goodbye, and God bless is our prayer. Thank you so much for tuning in today to our broadcast. I do hope that you would like and share the broadcast to help us reach more people. That would be a tremendous blessing to us. Goodbye and God bless.